May grace, mercy, and peace be multiplied unto you from God, the Father, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. The Word of God, which is the basis of the sermon this morning, is a portion of the epistle lesson read earlier from the book of Revelation. Recall your attention to chapter 5, verses 9 and 10, where we read as follows again that portion of God's Word, which will be the sermon text. And they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. So far the text. In the name of Jesus Christ, our great God and Savior, who gave himself on our behalf, dear fellow redeemed sinners and creatures of the one true only living, creating and preserving, triune God. The season of Lent, we are especially mindful of the events of surrounding the death of Jesus. The night before he died on the cross, he had what we call the Last Supper with his apostles in Jerusalem. At that Last Supper, he instituted what we now call the Lord's Supper of his body and blood. The Bible tells us that at that Last Supper, the devil was there. Satan, it says, entered into the heart of Judas to leave that supper early and to go and reveal Jesus' location to the Pharisees and the high priest, who were wanting to have Jesus crucified. It was as if Judas was a slave of Satan. It says that Satan made Judas do this. That Judas simply marched to the orders of Satan. Well, actually, he was a slave of Satan. But he wasn't alone. He wasn't the only slave of Satan. Every human being, by nature, is a slave of Satan. Most people are totally unaware of it and will not admit it, but that's why they sin. They're following his orders as obedient slaves. The Bible paints the human race as a bunch of slaves. And I'm sure that in reading about the history of our country, you've read about the slaves back before the Civil War and how there were slave markets where they would bring in a bunch of slaves and they would put them up on stage and they would auction them off and sell them. And the bidders would be down wanting to buy slaves. Well, that's the way the Bible pictures the human race. We are all slaves in a slave market. And we are owned by Satan originally, but God comes to us in the person of Jesus Christ, and he wants to buy us from Satan. And so Jesus Christ pays the price. And the price is his own blood unto death. And so we become then not slaves of Satan, but now slaves of God, servants of God. And that's not a bad thing to be, because now for the first time, we can do God's will. We belong to God. And we can do his will and not sin all the time. We are freed from slavery to Satan. So, This is the way to look at Good Friday, when Jesus is hanging on the cross, shedding his blood unto death. He is in the slave market, paying the price to buy us back, to redeem us. And that's what we are going to talk about in the sermon this morning. The redemption that Jesus made for us when he gave his blood, he shed his blood unto death. What did that do for us? What did that do for us when Jesus died on the cross? When he bought us back to God by his blood. It says in our text, these people are saying to Jesus, "Thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood." He bought us back. And the price that he paid, as it clearly states here, was his blood. No lesser price would do it. It had to be the death of Jesus. And you have to know who Jesus is to see that that price was infinite. Because Jesus is not only a man, he is not only a perfect, sinless man, he is also God Almighty. So he is the perfect God-man. He is God the Son, the second person of the Trinity, who came down from heaven to become also a man so that he could die, he could have human flesh and blood, and he could offer it up in payment for us, pay for our sins, buy us back from God. No lesser payment could do that. It had to be the blood of God himself. It had to be totally sinless, innocent blood. And he is the only human who could ever meet that requirement. So, the Bible says, Jesus washed us from our sins in his own blood. Listen also to other things that the Bible says about this. It says, "Ye were redeemed from your vain conversation with the precious blood of Christ." Again, the Bible says, "The great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity." Now, in this text, what I have just said to you is called a new song. A new song. This is the new song. Now, as I said a moment ago, in verse 9 it says, they sung a new song. God loves singing. He gave us voices that we could sing with. God likes to describe things as songs. But this isn't literally a song. As in the book of Revelation, most things are symbolic. What this song symbolizes is the New Testament era. It's a period of time in world history. It is the time between when Jesus Christ died on the cross, rose from the dead, and ascended into heaven, looking at all that as one event, between that period and when Jesus comes again, descends from heaven in all of his glory, with all of the holy angels with him, at the end of the world. We call that the New Testament era. The end of the Old Testament era, the beginning of the New Testament era. The two great eras of world history that Jesus stands right in the middle of, the dividing point. And lo and behold, God has so engineered it that even secular, unbelieving people refer to it that way every time they write the year. 2017, the 2017th year of the New Testament era. So that's the new song. The new song is this message that will go forth throughout the New Testament era. The message that Jesus has come, God has come, and has died for the sins of the world, and has redeemed us slaves to God by His blood. The old song was the Old Testament, the Old Testament era. And the whole purpose of the Old Testament era was to prophesy the coming of Jesus, the coming of God the Son, how He would come and die for the sins of the world. And so, in the Old Testament era, all the worship was about blood, killing animals. They were symbols of the coming Jesus, the coming Christ. They would kill animals every day in the temple to remind the people every day of the coming Savior who would shed His blood to buy them back from Satan. The Passover was a symbol of this. Once a year, they would kill the lambs. And that would symbolize the coming Lamb of God, the real Lamb that would really save us and buy us back to God. That was the old song. But now, you don't need symbols anymore. You don't need to kill animals anymore, because Jesus Himself has come. That's the new song. We live in the New Testament era today. We don't need symbols anymore in the new song, because now we know who the real Lamb of God is. We know that He has really already come. He has already been slain, and all of our sins have been paid for. What a wonderful song this is. What a joyous song this new song is. The Bible says it this way: by His own blood He entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. And again, listen to the Bible: and for this cause He is the mediator of the New Testament, the new song. And what are the words of this song? Well, it tells us right here in verse 9, they sung a new song saying, "Thou, Jesus, art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for Thou wast slain." That's what starts the whole New Testament era. Jesus was slain. Before that was the Old Testament era, looking forward to Jesus dying. After He had died and ascended into heaven, now the New Testament era could begin. So He is now worthy to open the book. And the book is the New Testament era. That's what the rest of the book of Revelation is all about, opening up the seven seals of the New Testament era. A prophecy of what will happen between Jesus' ascension and visible return. And they aren't seven seals end on end. They are seven different angled views of the same period of time. So every time a seal is opened now from here to the end of Revelation, that is one particular view of the New Testament era, which we know now will be at least 2,000 years long. How much longer it will be, no one knows. Could end at any time. But that is the book with seven seals, the New Testament era. And here God is revealing this future to the world through John the Apostle, in this vision of the book of Revelation. So, here we have the book. Once Jesus had been slaughtered, the Lamb had been slaughtered, had shed all his blood, he now is worthy to begin to open the seals of this final scroll of human history. The whole purpose of the New Testament era, the whole purpose of this book, the whole purpose of the time span between Jesus' ascension and return is one. It's to sing the new song, the gospel, to tell everybody throughout the whole world that Jesus is their God, their Creator, and their Redeemer, so that they may be bought back from Satan to God forever. That is why there is a New Testament era, so that people can come to know, to hear, to learn, and to believe in Jesus Christ as their God and Redeemer. So, getting the word out. Now let's talk about the blood of Jesus. When the blood of Jesus was shed on the cross unto death, several things happened at that point. I want to go down a list of them for you. First of all, the Bible says, when Jesus shed his blood on the cross, this is the message that everyone must hear. The Bible says, quote, "We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ." The first thing that accomplished when Jesus shed his blood, it ended the warfare, the rebellion, the enmity between man and God. Man by nature fears God. When Adam and Eve first sinned, what did they do? What's the first thing they did? They ran and hid from God, because they were afraid of God. That is a fear that's natural to all people. Peace with God is the opposite of that. Now we no longer have this servile fear of God. Oh, we still have a fear of God, but it's a childlike fear. Big difference. Not the fear of a slave to a master, but the fear of a child to his father. Now we have peace with God. No longer do we fear his punishment upon our sins, for Christ Jesus has taken that punishment in full for us. Second thing that we have, because Jesus shed his blood, is it tells us here in the text, because Jesus has, he was slain and has redeemed us to God by thy blood, it says, and has made us unto our God kings. Did you know that you are now a king? You are, in the sight of God. Anyone who believes in Jesus as his Lord and Savior has become a king that will reign, it says, will reign on the earth. Well, how does that happen that the Christians, the true Christ believers, rule this earth? Well, what's the power of God? The Bible says the power of God is the Bible, his word. The power of God unto salvation. As long as we have this, we reign on earth. This is the power of God in our hands, and it shall never pass away. Now, it may pass away in some churches. Some churches may abandon the Bible, but they're putting down their sword. They're putting down the power of God. They no longer will reign. They will fade away. But we should not give up any of this word, not a single syllable of it. This is the power of God in our hands to reign on earth. so that the gospel, the message of salvation, will go forth, Jesus said, into all the world, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Though all the attempts of Satan and his minions will attempt to squash and to stamp out the church and the Bible, it will never happen until Jesus returns. So we will reign on earth with the power of God in our hands. This all was accomplished by Jesus when he shed his blood on the cross. So, we are kings. And then thirdly, the text also says that by his blood, not only are we made in, he has made us unto our God kings, also says that he has, by his shedding of his blood, made us priests. Luther was very strong on this in the Reformation, with the priesthood of all believers. Because you see, the papist church says, oh no, you're not all priests as Christians. Priests are only those who are appointed by the Pope. If the Pope doesn't appoint you a priest, you're not a priest. You can't go directly to God. You must go through the church. You must go through the priest. Luther said, oh no. The Bible clearly says all believers are priests. Now, a priest is a go-between, a mediator, a person who stands between the sinners and God. He carries the sacrifice of the people for their sins to God, and then he carries the word of forgiveness back to the people. But you see, all Christians are priests. We all have that ministry. We all have that duty. We were anointed priests when we were baptized. And therefore, we are mediators between the unbelievers and God. We are to bring to the unbelievers God's word of forgiveness in Christ Jesus so that they too can believe out of all nations and kindreds and tongues and people. That's one of our duties. We are priests. Priesthood of all believers, Luther called it. And so we represent God to the world. We carry God's word, law and gospel, to the people of the world. So we are to tell others that they no longer need to be slaves of Satan. They can now be freed from that. Jesus has bought them with his own blood. What else has Jesus done with his blood? Well, by being slain on Good Friday, Jesus also made it possible for us to be made saints. This is something else that the Reformation brought out. Saints weren't just certain people in the church, certain believers in Christ. But that's what the church was teaching, that only certain Christians were saints. The really good ones, they said. The really good Christians were the only saints. But you see, that again goes contrary to the Bible. The Bible says every believer in Christ is a saint, a perfect person, a sinless person in the eyes of God, a sanctified person. We are all saints who believe in Christ. You'll notice that in the epistles of the New Testament, most of them begin being addressed to certain people in certain places, certain Christian churches, whether it be in Ephesus or Galatia or Colossae or wherever. They all begin by saying, to the saints in Rome, to the saints in Corinth, to the saints in wherever. Because they're written to all Christians, and all Christians are saints, as it says, called to be saints. We say this in the Apostles' Creed, as we said a moment ago. I believe in the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints. It has always been the teaching of the true Christian Church that every true believer in Christ is a saint. This was all made possible when Jesus shed his blood on the cross. What else did Jesus' blood make for us? Well, by being slain, Jesus made it possible for us to become children of God. Children of God. And if children, the Bible says, then heirs of everything that God has. We will inherit everything of God's as his children. Made possible when Jesus redeemed us with his blood. Made us not only servants of God, but children of God. One other thing that Jesus did for us when he shed his blood, it says he made us to be unto our God kings and priests. One other thing priests do, they not only come to people with the word of forgiveness in Christ, they also carry people's prayers to God as a go-between, the mediator between sinners and God. So that now we can go directly to God in prayer as priests. Anytime, anywhere, all day long. Anytime we speak to God in our minds or in our words and in our speaking, any form whatsoever, we can talk to God as priests. We don't need to go through a saint, some dead person, or some official of the church. This is part of being the priesthood of all believers. Each one of us has a direct pipeline to God. Jesus accomplished this when he shed his blood and redeemed us to God. What else? We talked about this in Bible class today a little bit. True knowledge, knowledge of the truth, comes only from God. And God gave us knowledge through Christ Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. If you don't know Jesus, you don't know the truth. You're being deceived by Satan, the great liar. But in Christ Jesus, when you have faith in him, you come to know the truth about where you came from and where you're going and what this world is all about and what life is all about. It has meaning. It has beginning and ending. You know the Alpha and the Omega. You know the knowledge of God. The Bible says, you're enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. Now, the world will not recognize this with a degree after your name, but God recognizes it. You now know God. Jesus accomplished this knowledge in us when he shed his blood on the cross and redeemed us to God. There's more that Jesus did for us with his blood on Good Friday. He made it possible for all of us to have eternal life. Eternal life. Listen to the Bible. Jesus said, verily, verily, meaning truly, truly. You can trust this. I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation. Listen again to what the Bible says. What shall we then say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? We have eternal life because Jesus shed his blood and redeemed us from Satan. Jesus, by his blood, has given us peace with God. Jesus, by his blood on the cross, has made us to be kings on earth. Jesus, by his blood on the cross, has made us to become priests unto God. He has made us to become saints. He has made us to become children of God. He has, by his blood, made us to have all knowledge of the truth of eternity. Jesus, by shedding his blood on Good Friday, has made it possible for everyone to have eternal life with God in heaven. You cannot achieve any of these things by yourself. Only Jesus could do this, and only he could do it by shedding his blood unto death. Now, most people think they have all those things without Jesus, by virtue of their own goodness. However, they are wrong. Only Jesus can accomplish these things for us, and he did accomplish these things for us. It's an historical fact. He was crucified and he did rise on the third day to prove it to everyone. Jesus only opens up all of these things to anyone who believes in him. The problem is, most people don't believe this. They don't believe in Jesus as their creator and their redeemer. And so in our text, in verse 9, it says that Jesus, by being slain, hast redeemed us to God by thy blood out of every kindred, tongue, people, and nation. Doesn't say that everybody will go to heaven, does it? Did you catch that? You see where it says that? Doesn't say that every kindred, every tongue, every people, and every nation will have all of these things. It says that they will be out of every kindred, out of every tongue, out of every people, and out of every nation. That means only a partial group will come out of every nation. Not everybody in that nation, but they will come out of every nation. Only some will believe in Jesus. Only some will believe that he is the one who has redeemed them with his blood. Now, Jesus did shed his blood for all people. That's true. He did redeem all people. He did save all people. But most people, Jesus said, will not believe. Will not believe that Jesus, when he died on the cross and shed his blood unto death, was giving them their only hope. Most people will not believe that Jesus Christ, 2,000 years ago, paid the price to buy them back from Satan. They will want to remain slaves of sin. They like their sin, and they stubbornly will remain in their sin. They will not repent. It's true in Jesus' day, and it's true today. So, only some out of every kindred and out of every tongue will believe in Christ as their God and Savior, their Redeemer. The Bible describes the unbeliever in these words, denying the Lord that bought them. This text, these two verses in the book of Revelation, make it clear that only those who have faith in Christ as their Redeemer will be made unto our God kings and priests. Without that faith in Christ, they are not kings on earth and they are not priests on earth. Faith in Christ is what makes the difference, so that you come out of every kindred and out of every tongue and out of every people and out of every nation. You come out of them. You come to God. As slaves bought at the slave market by Jesus paying with his own blood. A few years ago, there was a man in Edwardsville who died. His name was Edward Nicole. He had written a will before he died. And I'd like to read to you the preamble that he wrote to his will. It went like this. My prayer will continue to be for my children, grandchildren, and their offspring to hold fast to Jesus, no matter what it takes, and to live according to the principles God gave us by his example and in his holy word. It is the only way to eternal glory, and nothing else really matters. Those who believe in Christ alone as their Redeemer and the Lord of their life are no longer slaves of Satan. They are now Jesus' servants, God's servants. And to them, the Bible says these words, "Ye are not your own, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body." Amen.